There are several important ideas that bring us today's implant. The first one I'm going to talk about is a standard. We needed several types of standards. One of them is how much power can be deposited in the body safely. In 1992, there was a neck cell phone cancer lawsuit where a woman had been holding a cell phone against the left side of her head and had gotten a brain tumor there. This resulted in a lot of research, and in 1996, the ANSI IEEE FCC C95.1 standard for specific absorption rate was established. This said that in the United States, the SAR limit of 1.6 watts per kilogram averaged over 1 gram of tissue was the maximum allowable SAR. In Europe, this is the Senelac guideline, and it's 2 watts per kilogram averaged over 10 grams. We also needed a standard for frequency. The Industrial Scientific Medical, or ISM, bands had been established in 1947 for many applications. In bioelectromagnetics, the particular bands we found important were 433, 915, and 2450 megahertz. In 1999, a dedicated mix band from 402 to 405 megahertz was established. This is the Medical Implant Communication Services band, and it's dedicated for this particular application. So with a standard, we also needed a way to design our antennas. Simulation tools in the 1990s were just beginning to be heterogeneous. Prior to that, we had used very canonical models such as spheres and cylinders, but the inside of a person doesn't look at all like a sphere or a cylinder. Heterogeneous modeling in the 1990s enabled us to not only figure out how much power went into the head from an external device, but also how much power was passed around in the body from an internal device. So with a standard and some simulation design tools, let's look next at antenna types. The first paper on microstrip antennas was seen in 1953. However, the book by Pozar and Schubert in 1995 had a huge impact on bioelectromagnetics. This is at a time there was no IEEE Explorer, there was no Google, and books were very important, and they really did drive research areas. So the microstrip antenna book led to a lot of ideas that were based on microstrip antennas for bioelectromagnetic devices. One of those is the PIFA, or the planar inverted F antenna. The first paper on PIFAs was seen in 1982. It was written in Japanese. In 1987, the name planar inverted F appears. A PIFA antenna has a flat plane, might be any shape at all, and it has a feed point and a ground pin that make up the rest of the F. So with a standard, some simulation and design tools, and a good antenna type, the next thing to consider is the implant case size. This is a picture of a pacemaker, one that was inside one of my students, in fact. In 1983, there was a lot of work done on finite ground planes. A pacemaker is definitely a small and finite ground plane. So being able to understand how antennas behave when their ground plane is no longer infinite was very important to the design of antennas that went for medical devices. So with a standard, simulation and design tools, a good antenna type, and an understanding of how the implant case size is going to impact antenna performance, we next look at biocompatibility. Biocompatibility is seen in two ways. One is the materials that the antenna is built from, and in this case, plastics and ceramics were appropriate. But also, the importance of the SAR guideline, which tells us that we can't have super high power right next to the antenna inside the body, made us use a dielectric superstrate. The dielectric superstrate was first seen in 1982. It's a protective covering for an antenna. This paper was not yet seen in the body, but very quickly this was picked up by the implant community. What this does is it basically separates the body by using this dielectric superstrate so that the high SAR values would be very near the antenna in the plastic as opposed to in the body itself. So with a standard, simulation and design tools, an antenna type, an understanding of implant case size, and a biocompatibility capability, we're now ready to move on to what really happened with implantable antennas. Let me tell you the story of Sam's pacemaker. Sam was a climber. He was an undergraduate in my electromagnetics class in 1999. He had to miss class in order to have his pacemaker replaced. This is his old pacemaker that you see the picture of. He wanted better communication with the pacemaker so that he didn't have to go to the doctor all the time. He wanted to be able to tell his heart to beat vibrantly when he was climbing, but to be more relaxed when he was sitting in my class. So he did a design on a senior project for pacemaker communication. The technological challenges that we were working on was the limited size for the frequency that we needed, the ground plane, biocompatibility, bandwidth, and what frequency we should use. So in 2002, at the IEEE AP Symposium, we presented some work on spiral and serpentine antennas. We used a non-uniform superstrate material, the resonant frequency of the PIFA, the finite ground plane of the titanium pacemaker. We basically took a dipole antenna, split it in half by putting a ground pin right there on the left. That made it into a PIFA. We then rolled it up, coiled it up either in an S or a serpentine in order to make the antenna smaller in size. And that basically made the antenna that was a PIFA, a coil or a serpentine PIFA shape. The spiral and the serpentine PIFA had interesting current distributions. If you notice in the spiral case, the strong current was seen at the end of this antenna, which would be unusual for a dipole, and that's because of the cross-coupling between the arms. In the case of the serpentine, you see a little less of that behavior. The frequency that we chose was 402 to 405 megahertz, and that was a good frequency because I could still build an antenna small enough to fit on this pacemaker, but also be able to have a low enough frequency to be able to transmit outside of the body. We considered the effect of the shorting and ground pins. So the red pin is the feed pin, the blue pin is the ground or the shorting pin, and you can see that as you move these, you change the resonant frequency and the depth of the S11 of this antenna. We considered different materials for the substrate and superstrate, and you can see as you use a high dielectric material, the resonant frequency goes lower. That's effectively making the antenna get bigger. And as you use a low dielectric, the frequency goes up, effectively making the antenna smaller. So a high dielectric lowers the resonant frequency. The difficulty at this time was that there were not very many high dielectric materials that could be used that were also biocompatible. So the three that we chose here were Teflon, Maycor, and Alumina, with dielectric constants ranging from 2 to almost 10. We also considered the effect of the superstrate. And the important part of the superstrate was there were very few materials that would truly hold out all body fluids. So I said, well, what if you did get some body fluid inside your superstrate? This would basically act like a graded material and actually improve the performance of your antenna. So we considered both convex and concave superstrates over the high current density regions. Remember, those were at the center of the spiral, for instance. We considered the spiral serpentine antenna showed up again in 2004 with the work of Kim and Ramaswamy. They also considered the shape and length and the effect of the PIFA antenna and a superstrate material over the top. Notice they were using a dielectric that was 10.2. In 2005, we presented a genetic algorithm PIFA. This is a picture of just the metal part, then there'd be a superstrate over the top. And in this case, there wasn't a ground pin on the genetic algorithm antenna, just a feed point. Now, a genetic algorithm antenna is designed by taking a mommy antenna and a daddy antenna that look kind of like this random waffle and breeding them. If the mommy and the daddy both have metal, then the babies will have metal there too. If they both have air in that spot, then the babies will have air there too. And if the mommy and daddy both have air and metal, then the babies randomly will have that at that point. Then you test the babies to see how close they are to the performance that you want. This is all done in simulation in our case. And you throw out the babies that don't do so well, and you breed again the babies that did particularly well for your application. After a while, you get really a good antenna design. The thing is, you can't really understand the antenna, just that it's a random distribution of points that give good antenna performance. The spiral antenna PIFA also showed up again in 2006 for SAR analysis. You can see the feed and the ground in these pictures. And the serpentine antenna in 2008. This was used for continuous blood glucose monitoring. The spiral microstrip PIFA then was seen in 2011 again in the work by Huang and Kishk, and that was also at 402 to 405 megahertz on a rounded pacemaker. Now things were starting to get smaller at this point, not a lot smaller, but a little bit smaller, and they were starting to strain the capability of antenna design. So let's look again at SAM's pacemaker and the issues with bandwidth and frequency. So there was very little bandwidth with any of these designs. These were very narrow band. So in 1983, they were stacked microstrip antennas, not for biological applications, but they were used for broadbanding. And so very quickly, we saw that in picked up in bioelectromagnetics. These designs in 2006, 2008 show different broader band designs for antennas. The concept of broadbanding was to have multiple possible paths for the current of multiple different lengths, so that a low frequency would take a long path and a high frequency would resonate on a short path. So you can see that these designs accomplish that through physical structures. There were stacked and layered designs as well. In 2009, 11, and 12, we were seeing multiple layered designs where the feeds and one or two antenna pieces were layered over each other for the purpose of broadbanding. PIFAs were made with pie shapes and split ring resonators, again trying to increase the resonant frequency of these antennas. There was a three-band rectenna, also designed for implantable applications. Next came three-dimensional antennas. These were first presented in 1974 for aerospace applications, but by 2014, they were already readily being seen in implantable applications. So the types of 3D antennas were limited only by the size and shape of the device that people were attaching to. These were generally for endoscopy capsules that could be swallowed. So the goal was to have complete integration with a device in a small and three-dimensional shape. We saw much of the three-dimensional antennas in the 2011 through 15 timeframe. Now let's go back to Sam's pacemaker. After having designed a number of these, one of the serious problems that was limiting implementation in practical applications was the ability to manufacture those. The challenge would be taking these materials that would not allow any fluid, biological fluid, to enter them, and trying to glue those onto titanium, which also resists being glued to. So it was very difficult to keep these glued for a long term without fluid seeping into the cracks. So in 2013, we worked out a different design. It's actually the antenna built backwards. The superstrate was first molded. It's the purple thing that you see here. The superstrate was molded with a cavity into which the titanium antenna was placed. It would just be cut out of some titanium material, kind of like tinfoil. Then the pacemaker body would be placed over that and the ground plane on top of all of this. This made a much more manufacturable design that could hold together with tabs instead of just needing glue in order to hold it in one place. So now we've talked about the ideas that brought us to the implant, and in particular Sam's pacemaker, and how the designs flourished throughout the 1990s and the 2000s. With standard simulation tools, antenna type, implant case, and biocompatibility, we see all of these in today's designs. So now I'd like to talk about the next generation and the future. This is not your grandfather's pacemaker. The design that was 30 millimeters on a side is quickly shrinking to 4 millimeters.